Well, I need some water, please.
Hallelujah! He is risen. Death could not hold him in the grave. My brothers and sisters, what a wonderful time to be alive, alive in Christ. We are in that beautiful season of Easter, which is the most important of the Christian calendar, along with the Nativity of Christ. It is when Christians glorify and give thanks for the resurrection of Jesus Christ after his crucifixion, death, and burial, which we celebrated with Friday. Today, we give thanks that he, Christ, rose from the grave 3 days later, having conquered death and redeemed us from sin. His resurrection means the eternal life that is granted to all who believe in him. Easter is the joyful conclusion of the Lenten season of devoted prayer, fasting, and penitence. St. Paul says that if Christ is not raised from the dead, then our preaching and hope is in vain. 1 Corinthians 15:14. The resurrection affirms Jesus of Nazareth as the prophesied Messiah of Israel and the King and Lord of a new Jerusalem, a new heaven, and a new earth. Friends, the significance of Easter is Jesus Christ's triumph over death, giving us a time to rejoice. He is alive, alive forevermore. Stand to your feet and praise him with your hallelujah, for he is alive. Christ Jesus is truly alive. Thank you, a happy and blessed Easter to all. And now our final believers. Thank you. celebrating her birthday with us. Not so faithfully here in the church's center circuit, financially and physically. An educator by profession, she carried the position wherever she went. Never afraid to scold you, no matter your age, if you stepped out of line. As a discipline, so was her love, giving and helping wherever there was a need. Our community and church has not just lost a painting or an educator. We have lost in God a mother, a friend, a confidant, one who gave service of herself and will be greatly missed. Our sympathy and prayers goes out to our entire family, especially Moni, Ricardo, Anisha, Jonathan, and Jordan. Please stand with me for a moment of respect in the moment. Eternal rest be granted unto Dorothy's soul, O Lord, and may thy perpetual shine upon her. May her soul and the souls of all the faithfully departed rest in peace. Amen. We will remain standing as we continue our worship. The Lord is risen. Alleluia.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Alleluia.
The stone which the builders refused has become the head of the corner.
This is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes.
This is the day which the Lord has made.
We will rejoice and be glad in it.
The Lord reigns. Let us rejoice.
Our Lord reigns. We shall be glad and wait for his word.
And now our opening hymn, Lo in the Grave Who Dies. Please, sir.
Thank you.
because of what he has done. He raised from that dead because of us, to forgive us of our sins. Let us be grateful on this Easter morning for what Christ has gone through for us. He arose from the grave. And now we may be seated. Our confession and another. The commandments of our Lord Jesus Christ. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, the first commandment is, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one, and you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to you,
and a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another, even as I have loved you, that you also love one another.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and write all these to the laws in our hearts, we beseech you.
And now our confession and pardon together.
Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be holy in the church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray, and free us from joyful obedience through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord.
And now the senior lady chant, Reverend Seymour, will be just along with the guy.
we say happy Resurrection Day, happy Easter to everyone. This is a very special day in the Christian calendar. This is the day when our Lord and Savior Jesus came back from the dead. He went down to hell and loosed the gates so that no one can stay down there, but rather we can all have eternal life. And so, I'd like to welcome all of you who are visiting. Do we have any special visitors among us today? Okay, well. Yes, we have Kenwood Cartwright. Pastor Shamus. Okay, just stand and let us recognize you.
And your family.
And your family. Welcome. God bless you. May you receive a special blessing as you worship with us here at St. Paul's Methodist Church. I'd also like to welcome and indeed greet those who are celebrating a happy occasion in their lives. Happy birthday goes out to Galen Ware, Dakota Kim, Brother Burke Lightborn, and Emily Papia. And they're celebrating their birthdays, the 10th, the 13th, and I think today. And so, there may be persons who are celebrating anniversaries or other special occasions, but we're just going to sing for them and ask God to bless them.
And you want to have communion today. And now we will be led by our praise team. The praise team, please come forward. And this is the time when we can worship, we can stand, we can come, we can give praises to God. So let us stand and share with the praise team.
Did you say stand? I don't think they heard you. If you stand, please, let's worship God. I was telling someone, if I didn't know any better, as I looked down in the audience, I'm getting the impression that you think today is Friday. It's not. It's Resurrection Sunday. Lord Jesus. Come on, let's act as if he's risen. Amen? He is risen. Do you know I believe in Jesus? Do you know why he's so great? After 3 days, he rose from dead. I've never seen a man like this before.
From beginning to the end. Yeah. Members to come to church and to worship God, and day. But I guess to pray for those persons around here, and you don't know the reason why you're putting trust and pray like that, you know. And if, again, wherever they are, they find themselves worshiping God on this resurrection Sunday, because it's what we ought to be doing. God has done so much for us as a people. He came, he died, but it just didn't end there. Because had he died, then of course our faith would have been in vain. But he rose.
Hallelujah.
He rose on the third day. He rose. And he's alive forevermore. Amen? I said he's alive forevermore. I said he's alive forevermore. I said he's alive forevermore. Alive, alive, alive forevermore. Several things, but we cannot. I don't think we can mention it sufficiently enough. The death of our sister, and we want to thank God for her life and ministry among us. She's impacted so many lives in Grand Bahama, in this particular church, and throughout the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. And she was sorely missed. We ask that you pray for the family as they go through this very difficult time and period in their lives. And if you haven't lost a loved one, then of course you don't know how the family feel at this time. But we ask that you pray where you can call and where you can visit as well. Because trust me, the day is coming, your day is coming. Amen? And your day is coming, and it's a lonely feeling when you're in a place all by yourself, having lost a loved one. And you definitely want your family and friends, and particularly your church people, to surround you. So let us continue to pray for the family as they go through this very difficult time. For all arrangements, and thanks to the Decorating Committee for doing such a wonderful job for the sanctuary this morning. I'm getting it ready. A Bible study will resume, and the times are indicated, so please take it and read it. Our shut-ins, we ask you to continue to pray for them. And they're all listed here with the... We can omit Sister Dorothy because, of course, we know she will pass. But St. Andrew's, St. Paul's, and St. David's, please, we ask that you remember our sick and shut-ins. And, of course, visit and call. I think I called a brother the other day. I think Brother Duncan. And you can remember it's in the funny voice of cry. Yeah, that very dear my heart. And so, people need to hear from us. Our members need to hear from us. Okay, so I'm asking you, I'm begging you, reach out and touch these people wherever they are. Okay, reach out and touch them. Pick up the phone. If you can't visit, call them. Pick up the phone. Let them hear your voice and pray with them on the phone. Okay? Sympathy goes out to the sisters, sympathy to Sister Patricia Bethel and Alberta Hall, and of course, Una Bethel, on the death of their aunt, Kathleen, the married in Nassau. The funeral services will be held, I think, on Thursday, the 13th in Nassau. We ask that you remember those persons in your prayers. So you can Our circuit preachers meeting is this Monday, the 11th, is it? Tuesday, right here at St. Paul's at 6:30. And then the circuit council meeting is on Wednesday at 6:30 as well at St. Paul's. Our meeting, the monthly, weekly meetings and events are listed in the bulletin. I couldn't read them. You can take the bulletin home and read it for yourselves, or please be governed accordingly. And then pay attention to the order of service for next Sunday, which is Youth Sunday. I think those are the notices. Please take the bulletin home with you. We ask that you stand now as we offer God our tithes and offering for the prayer. Let us pray. Father, we thank you once again for this Resurrection Sunday. We thank you, Lord, that you will redeem men back to you by allowing your Son to come, bled and died and resurrected for our sins. We pray, Lord, that we will ever be mindful of the precious death and pray for all of our redemption. We pray, Lord, now that we come to this part of the service where we are all able to give. We give as you would have blessed us. And we pray, Lord, that we would give according to your blessings you would have empowered all of us with. Bless our tithes and offering as we collect them, as we take them up to you, and use them all to the honor and glory of your kingdom here on earth. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
love to him and we're just too. And so this morning, I want Henry Cartwright to please stand. He is the island administrator. Henry, where are you? We are always happy to have you. God bless you. May you have a happier Easter just for being here this morning. And wherever you worship, please take our loving prayers with you. And since we're doing that, I want to welcome my niece and her family, Shamus. Shamus is traveling from the U.S. just to be with us this Easter. And Shamus, thank you. Eldor, how do you pronounce it again? Eduardo, sorry. And your beautiful daughter, Christina. God bless you all. Take your love to Anime and Tina for us and tell them we miss them, we love them, and a happy and blessed Easter. I know Shamus is very into the church where she worshiped in the Methodist Church, and Shamus is one of those who after the hurricane came out and bought so many things. And I don't know if she bought that $500 check for us this morning, but there is a $500 check on the way from one of our organizations, and so we thank you in advance. Gracious God, you are a consuming fire, and your word gives us light to light to be in this dark world. Satisfy us, Lord, every day of our lives to read your word and to be filled with your Holy Spirit.
Make us to trust in you even more, to know your word and to hide your word in our hearts, so that we may constantly make
and we have that opportunity right now to hide God's word in our hearts as we hear our readers, from our readers, who will read our Old Testament verse, Sister LaShonda Simmons from Acts 10, 34 to 43, and immediately following Sister Laverne Henderson, Colossians 3, 1 through 4. May our readers please stand forward.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Then Peter began to speak to them. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every people, anyone who fears him and practices righteousness is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. How he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did, both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. But God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses, and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Colossians 3, 1 to 4. So, if you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things that are above, not of things that are on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden, Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed with him in glory. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
If we are faithful, we will see Jesus. We will behold him. We will see him face to face. Little technical difficulty. I call it a commercial break.
The ocean is dry.
gospel comes to us from John chapter 20, and the reading, verse 1 to 18.
Glory
to you, Lord God. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciple set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there, and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying on the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed, for as yet they did not understand the scripture, that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes, but Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white, sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned away and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing that it was the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not touch me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father, but go to the brothers and say to them, I am ascending to the Father, and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them that he had said to her these things. This is the gospel of Christ.
Praise be to Christ our Lord.
the garden, the jail, the hammer, the nail. How could a night be so long?
Patricia, Dickenson, to the praise team, the choir sisters, and all of you, the ushers, as we worship God here this morning. Truly, it is a beautiful morning. I always loved Easter morning services. You can see everybody in their pretty white dresses or pretty dresses, and persons are dressed in their Sunday best to show that, yes, it is not just spring, but Jesus is alive. Amen?
Amen.
And so we celebrate his resurrection on this beautiful Sunday. And with those who are worshiping with us via media, we welcome you as well. My text comes from John chapter 20 and verse 17. Jesus saith unto her, "Touch me not, For I am not ascended to my Father, but go to my brethren, and say to them, I ascend unto my Father and your Father, to my God and your God. Let us pray. O gracious God, our heavenly Father, we give you thanks for your word and the power of your word. Your word that you say will not return to you void. And ask that your word spoken by me that it will comfort us, challenge us, and inspire us. O Lord, who is our rock, our help, our strength, and our redeemer. Amen. Every portion of scripture is loaded with sermons. And that is why whenever we read the scripture, not just the treasure that is hidden in the scripture, it is the power of the Holy Spirit who reveals to us what God says. And so sometimes you may read the scripture and you don't get something out of it. But when you read it over again, you say, but I never saw this here before. And it was there all along. And it is the Holy Spirit who reveals to us the truth or the hidden messages that are in the scripture. As we look at the resurrection story of Jesus, it is more than fascinating because it is a great implication of which goes on beyond the miracle in itself. And that implication beyond the miracle in itself is that God raised Jesus from the dead. And as Paul said, if Christ be not raised, we might as well go back home. If Christ be not raised, there's no reason for us to celebrate Easter, because Christ is the reason for Easter. Christ is the reason for the resurrection. Christ is the reason to celebrate that we will be raised from the dead as well, and we will be forgiven for our sins. And so there is so much evidence of Jesus' resurrection, as he appeared to his disciples many times. Should we accept Jesus' birth, then we should also accept his death and his resurrection. The text about Mary wanting to touch Jesus and him saying, do not touch me, has baffled many. And I am sure many persons are wondering why Jesus would say to Mary Magdalene, don't touch me. When a theologian dissected this verse, he said, Jesus was saying to Mary Magdalene, do not hold on to me. Do not think that I am here to stay as before. Because when you read the portion of scripture that the verse that passes afterward, it says, because I have to ascend to my Father, your God, and my God. In other words, it's not going to be business as usual, Mary. I am going up into heaven. And so that is why he said that. Because he would not have said to Mary Magdalene, do not touch me. And then when he appeared to his disciples, he would say, when Thomas was not there, he wanted to know, is it really Jesus? Jesus says to him, yes, put your finger here, put your finger in my hands and in my side. Touch me. And you can see that I am the Jesus who you are thinking about is raised from the dead. And so it explains it very well. Do not hold on to me, Mary, but rather go and tell the brethren that I am alive and I will go before them into Jerusalem. We have to come to believe in the resurrection of Jesus Christ, even though we are here some 2,000 years later. Imagine that. We have not seen, and yet we have come to believe. The biggest evidence of the risen Christ is not only through his disciples, but through one of Jesus' disciples who became a disciple, or rather, who became an apostle. And an apostle is one who is sent. And so when Jesus' disciples, they were disciples because they were learning, they were under his discipline. But afterward, when Jesus left, they became apostles. He sent them out, go out into all the world and preach the gospel. And so that is how Paul became an apostle. Paul was sent out into all the world. Paul met Jesus on the road to Damascus. Remember that Jesus had already died and risen again. But here it is, Paul is persecuting Christians. He is saying to them, why are you following this dead person who is not around anymore? Why are you lifting up the name of Jesus when he should not be? Paul was crucified, he was persecuting, and he was really getting rid of Christians. And on his way to Damascus, a bright light came and knocked him off his horse, and he fell on the ground. And he said, and the voice said, Paul, why are you persecuting me? Well, his name was Saul then. And he said, who are you, Lord? And he said, I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. So this voice could not say this if the voice was not real. And so Jesus indeed was alive then as he spoke to Paul. And he told him to get up and to go to Ananias, who would teach him. And God was already preparing Ananias for Paul. Because when God spoke to Ananias, he said, I am not going to deal with this man. This man has been killing Christians. And surely he would harm me. But he said, no, you go. And he will come to you. And so Paul came to Ananias. Paul was blind. And as Ananias started to teach him, it said that the blindness fell from his eyes like scales as he began to know who Jesus was. Jesus said, I will show you how you will suffer for me. And Paul did suffer. But Paul was happy about the suffering because he caused many to suffer. He killed many. But here it is. This staunch Jew became a Christian. Imagine that. So you have to know that Jesus is alive because he could change a man like Paul who was so serious as to kill persons. And now he is turning away from what he hated, those he hated, and even spreading the good news that Jesus is alive. And we gain a lot from Paul because Paul wrote more than any of the other apostles. Paul became like one of the first pastors of the church. As we know, from the love chapter, he says what love is, love and what love is not. Paul teaches us about the Holy Spirit, about all of us being members of the body of Christ. Paul teaches us so many things in his pastoral letters to the Christian church. And so you can see that God really chose this man. God really spoke to this man. God really equipped this man to help us in the church dogma, to help us in the ways of church decorum. And Paul indeed met Jesus. So Jesus is alive. He proclaimed Jesus, and Paul himself did many miracles in Jesus' name. I saw some televangelist was sending a piece of cloth around for persons to buy and say, this is the cloth from Paul, and if you touch it, you'll be healed. And so, I don't know about that, but if you have faith enough to do that, you can drink water and be healed. Amen? Just to know that you are in Jesus' presence is healing enough. And so the apostles, when they heard about Paul's conversion, they did not believe it right away because they knew of a man who was killing Christians, and now he is saying that he is one of us. How could that be? You know what? We all know, as the psalm says, the vilest offender can turn and find grace. There's none of us who is so bad that we cannot find grace in Jesus Christ. There's nothing that you have done so bad that you cannot find grace in Jesus Christ. I was speaking with someone a few days ago, and he was telling me of some things that he did years ago, and he said, you know what, they're still on my mind. I said, you know what, that's your punishment. You enjoyed it, didn't you? Until you go to Christ, and you really say, Lord, forgive me, Lord, have mercy, then there would be a change. Amen? Jesus brings a change in our lives. A wonderful change. As Jermaine Hawkinson has come over me, he changed my life. And now I am free. And so the apostles of Jesus had to change their minds, because it says that persons who follow Jesus Christ, there will be these signs. Many signs and wonders will follow you when you are in Christ. And what are those signs and wonders? You'll be able to cast out demons. You'll be able to speak new tongues. You'll be able to take up serpents. How many of you afraid of snakes? Yeah. I don't want to challenge you today, now. Should I challenge you?
No.
Yes, I should challenge you. If you are in Christ, you should be able to pick up that snake, amen? Yeah. Somebody said no. All right, well, Paul says it right here. I'm not gonna argue with you. Paul says it. And so you have to ask God to take away that fear, amen?
Yeah.
So that you can indeed do one of these signs, as Paul says. And if you drink any deadly thing, he says, it will not hurt you. And you can lay hands on the sick, and they will recover. You know, some time ago, I don't know if it's still the same, but in the United States, they had a church full of snakes. And they said, you know, if the snake bites you, then you should be able to still live. And I think that many persons died. I don't think it's so literal like that. If you're going to do it like that, then you are at your own risk. Because God didn't tell you to go and bother with snakes, especially poison ones. Yes, and Jesus is alive. And we do not have to give anyone credibility. The credibility speaks for itself. So many persons, since Jesus has died on the cross and rose from the grave, we can speak about have that wonderful change in their lives. Or how much lives have been changed, you know, since they have met Jesus. And many persons are grateful that persons have become Christians, because it would be a crazy world. Do you know that? You better be glad that a lot of persons came to be Christians. A lady once said to a guy, she said, you know what? I'm so glad God hold on to you. Because you would have been so, so bad. And yes, that is how it is. And we are living in the last days of our own lives. We have passed through the Lent season, where we are traced for 40 days the temptations of Jesus. And as we are mortal ourselves, we should be convinced of God's gift to us, that Jesus is God's gift to us. And we, in return, give ourselves back to God. And that's the real reason why Jesus came, to reconcile us back to God. Sin separates us from God. But Jesus is our advocate, like our lawyer. He pleads on our behalf. And he tells God, give him another chance. Give him another chance. And every rope has an end. But if we don't ask, if we don't come, if we don't seek, if we don't knock, we don't get what God is offering us. For God gave the gift to us. As said in John 3:16, God so loved the world. He didn't say God so loved the Bahamas, because Bahamas is a Christian nation, or America, or Cuba, or any other place. God so loved the world. You look at the map and see all the countries of the world. Every country God loves. And that's why Jesus died. He didn't die for some. In our Methodist faith, we always say he died for all. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. All men are sinners. All men can be saved. All men can know that they are saved. And all men can be saved to the uttermost. That is what we believe. We believe in that. You know, the Calvinist theology is that, well, the way Calvinists speak about God is that, you know, you were born either to be good or to be bad. That's what they think. And so no matter what you do, you can't be saved. Because these ones are saved. No matter what these what good ones do, and even if they do bad, they're saved. And John Wesley said, no, it can't be like that. He said, Jesus died for all. Because if you're saying it like that, it cancels out race. You understand what I'm saying? God died for all. Jesus died for all. And because Jesus died for all can be saved. He didn't die for some. He died for all. And my brothers and sisters, that is what I want you to know today. And it was the slave ship owner who wrote the hymn Amazing Grace. That hymn, that testimony about his life, that he was blind and could not see until he realized God's amazing grace. And many persons will discover that that grace was always there for you. While we were yet sinners, God was working out his purpose to bring us back to him. His desire, for God wants none of us to be lost. It is why Jesus is the resurrection and the life. And he said, if you believe in me, though you die, yet shall you live. And those who live and believe in me shall never die. Let me tell you how serious it is. Matthew records that after Jesus was raised from the dead, some persons also came out of their graves. You hear me? The resurrection was so powerful that persons who believed in him came out of their graves. They thought it was resurrection morning. It wasn't yet. And it said that not only did they come out of their grave, but they also were found in Jerusalem. Many persons saw their loved ones who had passed walking about in Jerusalem. That's how serious it is. And if you read the Gospels really good, you know that when Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead, the religious leaders tried to kill him again. They tried to kill Lazarus again because they said, if this man is walking around as a testimony that Jesus raised him from the dead, people will believe in Jesus, so we need to kill him. We need to kill Lazarus. They was trying to kill Lazarus again. So Lazarus had to hide. And Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life. He could raise us up from our graves, no matter what state we are in. Jesus can raise us up. He can give us that new hope, that new joy. Just like how you see flowers bloom. Will flowers bloom again? Yes, the lilies are beautiful. They are pretty. They can bloom. Even the ones on the wall that are not so real, they can bloom too. Amen. You could stick some more in that. I'm sorry, decorators. They thought the flowers on the wall were real. But they are beautiful. And I remember I planted a citrus tree, and all the leaves dropped off. And I say, oh my money had gone down the drain. And I decided, you know what, I'm not going to give up on it. I put some fertilizer there, gave it some water, and the next thing I know, the thing started to put out new leaves. Amen. That's how it is with us. We may go through our dry season where everything falls off us, and we feel like we don't have nothing, and we are nothing, until God waters us and fertilizes us and encourages us, and we come back. We bloom, we blossom, we flourish. That is how it is, my brothers and sisters. And so Jesus is still giving life. Someone said that sometimes I feel discouraged. That's all right. Everybody has a time of feeling discouraged. And one Bahamian said, Stop discouraging me. It sounds so sweet, doesn't it? I think that's going to be a word in the dictionary soon. Yes, we feel discouraged and think that our work is vain, but then the Holy Spirit revives our soul again. And God gave Jesus, and Jesus gave the Holy Spirit. And that's why Jesus said to Mary Magdalene, do not go on to me. Because also, when Jesus went away, he said, I will send the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, who will be with you to teach you and to guide you into all truth. And so that is why Jesus went away, because the Holy Spirit is here to teach us and to guide us. And the Holy Spirit is really the presence of God and Jesus. And so as we worship, Jesus told Nicodemus, those that worship God must worship in spirit and in truth, because God seeks such worshipers. Jesus told the woman at the well. Come in a time when you won't have to worship God in this church, or on a mountain, or in a temple, or some altar somewhere, because true worshipers worship God in spirit and in truth. In your heart, in your mind, as you walk about, pray, sing, lift up the name of Jesus. You don't have to carry around a big Bible or a big cross, but you have to acknowledge him each and every day of your life and watch the bloom that comes out of your situations. The things that you used to do and say, you will do them no more, because Jesus is alive and well and working in your lives. What a wonderful Savior we serve. He's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I see his hands of mercy. I hear his voice of cheer. And just the time I need him, he's always there. He lives. Christ Jesus lives today. You ask me how I know he lives? He lives within my heart. And because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. I can pick up the snakes. Amen? Because I know he holds the future. And life is worth the living just because Jesus lives. You know, if somebody who's on the brink of suicide heard that, that could save them. Life is worth the living. Don't throw in the towel. Jesus died to save you. Don't kill yourself. Don't discourage yourself. Just turn to Jesus and believe in him and see what a wonder God will do in your life. He promised, and God cannot lie. He's the resurrection and the life. He raised Jesus, and Jesus promised on the last day that he will raise all of those who believe in him. Because he said, I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, though they die, yet shall they live. And those who live and believe in me shall never die. He said to Mary, believe you did this? She said, yes, Lord, I believe. Let us all believe and live as people of the resurrection. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Let us pray. Let us pray. O gracious God, Heavenly Father, we are yours. You have redeemed us through your precious blood. You have died for our sins, and you rose for our justification. And as we are here in your presence, in this beautiful sanctuary, in the warmth of fellowship, the hearts and minds can gather and focus on you. We give you thanks for the beautiful resurrection morning, when all will rise again, according to your will, your purpose, and your word. Bless your people, and if we have not given our hearts and minds to you, Lord, we surrender, and we ask that you would guide us and keep us, and heal us, Lord, from the crown of our head to the sole of our feet, every blood vessel, every sinew, every nerve, every cell, every muscle touch, heal, and restore. We pray for those who are behind prison bars, whether they are innocent or guilty. We ask, Lord, that you would be with them. For when the Son is set free, is free indeed. We pray for our children and young people, asking, O Lord, that you continue to equip them, those who are on the field and track and field for Karifta, those who are behind televisions, those who are idle on the streets, those who walk the streets, those who are everywhere. We bring them all before you, those who are here with us this morning. We bring before you ourselves, Lord, you know about us. You know our shortcomings, you know our failures, you know our triumphs, you know our weaknesses. Help us, guide us, and keep us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We continue on in our intercessory prayer. Let us pray it. With all our hearts and minds, let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, our Father, on this glorious feast today, we come today to offer praise and adoration for the risen Savior, because without the resurrection of your Son, our faith would be empty and without hope. But he is alive, and we rejoice in the knowledge that in Jesus, all that separates, injures, and destroys are being overcome by that which unites and heals and creates. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we pray for the church, universal, and give thanks for calling us into the company of those who trust in Christ and seek to obey his will. Lord, in your mercy. We pray that your Spirit may guide and strengthen us all in mission and in service to you, to our community, and to the world outside. In whatever way we can each contribute, and we pray that day by day we may draw closer to you, experiencing your infinite love for us. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for the congregation of this church and for our two sister churches, St. David's and St. Andrew's, and all who confess the name of Christ, that we may show forth the excellencies of him who called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. Lord, in your mercy, together, O Lord our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people here at St. Paul's. Look with compassion on us, and all of us turn to you for help, for you are gracious, Lord God, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. As the Lord has taught us, so we sing.
and for the reminder that no matter where we find ourselves in this life, whether in our dark nights, in our coldness, our brokenness, that once we turn to God's word, we will always find a scripture that will help us. And so, Rev, I extend my sincere thanks on behalf of all of us to your reminder this morning. May God continue to bless you and guide you as you continue your work in this part of Christian Yard. And I also extend thanks to our readers this morning of the Word of God, Sister Michelle Simmons and Sister Lorraine Henderson, for reading and doing it so wonderfully. It's always, always a pleasure when we can participate more than just in the pew, in the bishop's service. And so I give God thanks for all of you and Brother Seymour for the notices and announcement. And so we continue in our worship as we prepare our hearts to receive the sacrament of Holy Communion. And we will sing our preparation hymn, "Let us break bread together on our knees and make the meat seated."
It is right to the altar of grace.
But today especially, we praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb, who offered for us and has taken away the sin of the world, who by his death has destroyed death, and by his resurrection has restored us to everlasting life. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we join in the hymn of everlasting praise. Of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again.
All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen. The bread which we break is assuring in the body of Christ.
Amen.
The cup of blessing which we bless is assuring in the blood of Christ.
Amen. Though we are many, we are one body, because we share one loaf and partake of the same drink.
Let us pray our prayer of humble access.
Lord, we come to your table, trusting in your mercy, and not in the goodness of our own. We are not worthy to gather the promise of your table. It is our nature always to have mercy, and on that we depend. So feed us with the body and blood of Jesus Christ, your Son, that we may forever live in him and he in us.
Thank you.
life eternal that he gives to all of us. Born the power of the Holy Spirit to love and to serve, and may the God of peace be with you. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. thank you, Lord, for your goodness and sanctity. Unite us with Christ, and give us a foretaste of the heavenly banquet, prepared for all mankind.
Amen.
I'm closing.
Our closing hymn will be, Lord is my shepherd, I'll not want, he lives. It's sung to the tune of A Happy Wanderer, and it's really a joyful tune, so we will sing this tune together, and as we sing it.
So we stand and sing.
The Lord's my shepherd, I love more. He lays me down to lie in pastures green.
Been resurrected, and you are the resurrection and the life. and those who believe in him will never die. So we go out to proclaim that good news, not only with our lips, but with our lives. The blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And